I'll never forget Sister Shelley Margaret. What a kind, loving soul. She had a vibrant smile that could light up the night, and a heart so pure it could change the world. She was young and vivacious for a nun, but possessed a mature and loving nature that went well beyond her 28 years. There wasn't a child that Sister Margaret couldn't reach, and there wasn't a soul she'd come across that wasn't charmed by her warmth and tenderness. I just so happened to be one of those troubled souls that she comforted. She cared for all the children under her watch like they were her own, and we all loved her like she was our very own mother. So we all noticed when Sister Shelley suddenly went through a dramatic change. It all started after a stranger was seen roaming the hallways of the orphanage late one night. He was originally spotted by one of the other kids, but it was only after a high-pitched wail disrupted the night that we all got wind that something was terribly wrong. The blistering scream woke me out of a sound sleep, and it carried on for at least a minute after that. I exchanged befuddled stares with the other three kids I shared a room with, like one of them would have an explanation for what we heard. When we realized neither of us could solve the other's questions, we all got up and headed for our door, and of course, I was the silly one who was leading the way. We all stood in the doorway and scanned both sides of the hallway looking for anything out of place. I remember being super terrified because the hallways were pitch black, which none of us were used to. Then suddenly, each of our attentions were turned to a creaking door off to the right of our room. We all watched in silence as the shadowy figure of someone emerged from the room we all knew to belong to Sister Shelley. The shadowy figure bundled his coat tightly as he made his way up the hallway in our direction. The other three kids standing with me retreated back to their beds. I stood there alone as he passed me by in a hurry. He never looked my way or even acknowledged my presence. All I could tell of him was that he was very tall. He wore a black fedora and a long black trench coat with his collar lifted, perfectly shielding his face. The one discernible thing that gives me chills to this very day was the horrible smell attached to him. I was too young at the time to accurately describe what I smelled, but as an adult now, I can say without question that what I smelled that night was a much stronger dose of what sulfuric acid smells like. Anyway, the sulfuric smell lingered in the halls after the stranger departed. Once I was sure he wasn't coming back, I took it upon myself to go to Sister Shelley's room to check on her. I softly called out to her as I knocked on her door. She didn't respond. I turned the doorknob and called out to her again in a mouse-like tone as I slowly opened her door. For years, people have tried to convince me that what I claimed to have seen upon opening that door was merely a figment of my imagination. But as sure as I'm sitting here now, I know what I saw that night was real, and I'm beyond certain that it wasn't the exaggerated effects of an over-imaginative kid, because to be honest, I was anything but. I mean, I didn't exactly have the type of childhood that was conducive for an active imagination. What I saw when I opened that door was Sister Shelley floating several inches above her bed. Then out of nowhere, she suddenly dropped to the mattress. She was unconscious, lying halfway on her disheveled bed, her nightgown pushed up to her head, her underwear down around her ankle. Her room had been completely trashed and the air reeked of that same sulfuric smell. I was only 7 or 8 at the time, so I wasn't really able to interpret what I was seeing. I screamed for help, never taking my eyes off of Sister Shelley's limp, nude body. Eventually, other adults arrived. I was pulled away by one of them and led back to my room. I could clearly hear the others simultaneously gasping and praying over Sister Shelley, while someone else desperately tried to revive her. Me and my roommates watched from my window as Sister Shelley was loaded into the back of an ambulance. She remained at the hospital for some time, but I'll never forget how excited we all were when Father Bobby said he was going to pick her up and bring her back to the orphanage. Practically every kid in the orphanage surrounded Father Bobby's car with ecstatic energy as it pulled to a stop in the driveway. We were all happy to have our favorite nun back, but the instant I set eyes on her, I knew the person I was seeing wasn't the Sister Shelley I knew and loved, but something else. Something dark. I think some of the other kids felt the same way. Of course, the adults tried to convince us that Sister Shelley was recovering from a traumatic experience, and only through our prayers and patience would she return to us the way she once was. As I laid in my bed that night, staring up at the ceiling, I could hear my roommates saying their prayers, and I know for certain I heard Sister Shelley's name somewhere in all of them. I came close to praying for her too, but I hadn't slept in days as a result of the horrifying ordeal. And for some reason unbeknownst to me, I felt like my body was going into an automatic shutdown. Before I could whisper a quick prayer for Sister Shelley, I found myself quickly drifting off into a sleep that I couldn't fight off any longer. When I awoke later that night, to my surprise, I was all alone in my room and the door was wide open. I immediately knew something was up because there's no reason why all three of my roommates would have been gone at the same time, and the fact that the door was left wide open only added to my suspicions. I got out of bed and slowly walked over to the door. I peeked my head into the hallway, looking in both directions, but I didn't see anything or anyone. There was nothing but silence. I said hello, but there was no response. That's when I noticed that every door going in both directions of the hallway had all been left wide open. I started to think there was a fire alarm or something that caused everyone to leave and I just didn't hear it. But as I moved through the hall, I realized that that was unlikely because the alarm should have still been going off if that was the case. I glanced into every room I passed and they were all empty, the sheets on every bed eerily folded back in the same fashion. I continued on, looking for anyone who could fill me in on what was going on. I eventually decided to head for the main entrance in the hopes that maybe I would find everyone outside. At that point, I was still going back and forth with the whole fire alarm deal. I went downstairs, passed by the cafeteria, and was making my way past the recreational room when I caught a glimpse of something from the corner of my eye. I stopped just outside the dual doors of the rec room and stared through the glass windows of one of the doors, but I couldn't see anything through the darkness. I was just about to walk away when a glimmer of light caught my eye again. I reluctantly pushed the door open and stepped inside. I knew the light switch was to the immediate left of the doors, and I headed straight for it and flicked it up. What I saw when those lights came on haunts me to this day, and is the sole reason why I'm still in therapy 38 years after the fact, and totally dependent on antidepressants. Strewn everywhere within the massive room was the mutilated bodies of both kids and adults, still in their blood-soaked sleeping attire. I remember wanting to scream at the horrific sight, but I was frozen in fright. Kneeled down in the corner at the far right side of the room, facing the wall was Sister Shelly, fully dressed in her habit. She was whispering in tongues in a voice that was way too graspy to be her own. My heart sped up and my breathing grew heavy with panic. Sister Shelly's chanting suddenly stopped as she slowly turned to me. I peed my pants the instant my eyes locked on her disfigured face. Her eyes were as black as night with glowing yellow orbs in their centers. Her skin was a chalky, pale white, and her mouth was covered with fresh blood that dripped down her chin. And on her crown band was an upside-down cross that she had painted on with blood. The only thing I remember after that was her smiling at me. I don't know if I passed out or if my mind simply shut down in an act of self-preservation, but all I can say for sure is that the next thing I recall after that was sitting in the hospital room, listening to a couple of cops outside in the hallway talking about the killer nun. Apparently, when the detectives asked Sister Shelly why she had killed all those children and other nuns and Father Bobby, she said because they hurt her. When the detectives asked her what she meant, she told them that everyone who prayed for her was causing her pain, so she killed them all to end her suffering. There's a lot more to this story, but I'm afraid I can't go any further. Netflix has agreed to air my story, the story of Sister Shelly Margaret, and all those whose lives she took that night at the Brighton Orphanage in a 5-part documentary, but the deal requires that I not divulge too much information about the case. All I can say is that in the end of it all, my faith has become stronger than it's ever been. And if you decide to watch the documentary of Sister Shelly Margaret, you may find yourself reevaluating what your beliefs are as well.